Hello, and thanks for tuning in for part two of the Joker R1 video. Hope you enjoyed part one. Now we're going to take you through the portrait, because in part one you learned how to airbrush the card and the glove and the hand of the Joker. So basically, now that everything's chalked on, as in the original video, and it had all been sealed with a binder, with the section still masked up, which is the card, and the glove, because we want that sitting in the foreground. I'm now working using my original mix, the House of Color White, fairly thin. I'm just following my chalk lines and my reference, and basically what I'm doing is hitting all of the light areas first, but I'm building the shapes and shadows as I'm going. So a lot of you have probably seen me do this numerous times in videos, especially on dark surfaces, just like this black fairing. I always use white and I build everything as I go. Then I come back in with color and detail and go from there. In this case, it'll just be a blue-black mix, which we'll go to next. But you can see here where I'm doing the nose, I'm layering the white, so it is fairly thin. So don't just go one heavy hit, like basically build up your tones. I'm letting sections dry a little bit so that, working around the portrait basically. So using the air on all the time and just using my trigger finger to pull back on the paint and making sure that I'm not blowing out any areas and getting them too wet. So as you can see, because I'm going over certain sections, they gradually become lighter. So this will just give you a good end result. I'm also putting in texture. It is a bit hard to see, and I apologize for that sort of light glare off the video. I had that same problem in the first one, but so just bear with me. Hopefully you still learn a bit from this video. So you can see here I've almost mapped out the entire face. So because it's makeup, obviously we're using white for that reason, but you can see here I'm leaving the darker areas. So that way I know where I've got to go, because the white is actually eliminating my original chalk, which was done in that white chalk pencil. Now they are oil-free pencils, so they can be two-pack cleared, so you need to make sure. I'd recommend doing a test panel, because you don't want to go to all the trouble of drawing it out, getting all your artwork done, and then your chalk has oil in it or something, and it fries up your clear. So just definitely recommend doing a sample panel first. Okay, you can see here I'm working on the other fairing as well. So I've set both of them up. Unfortunately, with this part of the video, most of it I cover with the way the angle of the filming. So again, I apologize for that. But hopefully you can see enough. I mean, basically it's pretty much the same as the first step. You can see here I'm again layering the white, just gradually building it up on the nose there, putting in all of the detail. So continually check your reference. Also, a good tip with when you're doing any sort of portraits, even though this one is sort of more of a fantasy style portrait, I mean, it's got makeup and all that, you don't have to be as accurate, but it's always a good idea to step back from your artwork and just have a look. So that way, all the shapes and shadows become a lot clearer then from a distance, because when you're up really close working on it for numerous hours, everything sort of just tends to become merged and a bit of a blur. So I always recommend stepping back, having a look, and you can also squint your eyes, and that cuts the detail sort of out, and it shows you where all the shapes and shadows should be. Not so crucial with this first step, because we're going to go over and refine everything, but definitely something to keep in mind when you do other portraits. So you can see here, even with the hair, I'm putting the strands in. So just sort of building a tone so that I know where it goes, what sort of area it is, whether it's hair, skin. I'm identifying all of that, but I'm also putting down a base so that the other colors can sit on top of that, and it's going to create my artwork. So because of the fact that everything's masked up, this is pretty easy. I'm not too worried about overspray, because we can clean that up later. The good thing is the fairings are black, so just make sure there are numerous different blacks, so just make sure you use the right one when blending it back in. You can see here now I'm working in between the two. So just looking at my reference and noting which ones need a little bit extra here and there as I'm going. Again, it's not super stressful because this stage doesn't have to be super duper detailed. We're going to come back in later with the blue black and bring all that detail out. So just sort of getting a foundation for all the other colors to sit on. And again, sorry for the glaring off the filming, but yeah, I thought this would still be a cool video to show you guys. So here you are, you can see the white underpainting is complete. So that's sort of what it should look like. You can see it's not super sharp, but sharp enough so I know where everything has to go. Now I've switched to my blue black mix. So basically it's almost like a phthalo blue that I put into this black. It just tones down the black, and what it does is it takes the, because this is a, I think it was a PPG 740 black, it's quite brown when it's thinned and it sprays over white, and I didn't want that browniness to show through. This happens a lot with a lot of the different blacks. I think even House of Color has that brownish tinge. So it's, yeah, by putting a bit of blue or violet in, you can eliminate that. However, keep in mind it will give it a slight blue tinge, especially on a white. So depending on what look you're going for, but within this Joker portrait, if you had a look at the actual reference, it had that bluish tinge in it. So it's very, very hard to see. It still looks like solid black, but yeah, when you see it in real life, you can see that slight blue, and I think that effect looks really, really good. So you can see now what I'm doing is up close, and I'm actually shaping the hair. So when I do my strands of hair, I'm fairly close, but then I blend out from there. And you can see I'm working right around that forehead section. I sort of jump in all different spots of the portrait. So certain people like to start with the eyes or the lips or whatever. I like to just usually start in the darkest spots and then work my way around from there. So also by doing that, you can gauge how dark your other areas need to be. So if you say color in like where I'm doing it now, or in around the eye, which would be your darkest spot, then you know, okay, so that's what this black's gonna look like, or this blue black as a solid form. And then you can gauge all your other shadows off the reference for that. So you know, okay, you know that reference just above where that eyebrow section is fading off towards the hair, that's about half the intensity of the solid color. So that's what you would replicate. So that's how you get it fairly accurate. So that's also a good little tip for everyone. And that works really well with all artwork, especially portraits. So keep that in mind. So you can see here, I'm working off all of that uneven makeup, and I'm also blending in all of the unevenness. Here I'm doing the actual drop shadow from the card. Now you can see it's fairly thin, this blue-black mix, and I'm controlling it so that it's not just a black shadow. A lot of people do shadows and they do them really dark. A shadow should really just be a tint on that existing base color. And with something like this, it's always effective when you can see part of the portrait through it. I mean, it just gives that illusion that it is an actual shadow rather than just a big black rectangle coming off a card. So yeah, just keep that in mind, and obviously replicate what your reference says, especially when doing portraits. And obviously if your customer wants the portrait accurate, well then you just do what you see. So paint what you see is the easiest way to explain it. And you can see I'm cutting around that chin area, and I'm also blending back out into the existing black. Now, like I said earlier, make sure that your black matches up. I'm going to come back in with a solid black, which is actually the color of the fairing, later. This is just to eliminate some of the overspray as I go. The other black, which is the black from the fairing, will go and opaque over that and blend everything back in. So that's why I'm doing that at this stage. So you can see now the portrait's really starting to take shape. I'm just blending up around that mouth area there on the lips, and where his scar runs through, and that heavy makeup through where that mouth section is, and that ultimately gives him the Joker grin. The hair is still very scraggly. But we're going to fix all that up, and we're actually going to make the makeup more three-dimensional by adding white. So we're going to go back over with white, because what happens is the overspray that I'm creating now, and the shadows that I'm putting on the existing makeup that I've done earlier, that will provide a great base for the next white to sit on top. Because they're opaque colors, they do like to have a nice base, and then that will make a really stark bright white, and it'll give you that real chalky, dried up makeup look. So obviously, if your reference says otherwise, well, you wouldn't do it in this manner, but for these sort of pictures, anything with that sort of makeup look on the skin, and especially if the makeup's fairly light, like with a whitish color, this works excellent. So keep that in mind. All right, so we're working on the other fairing now, and I'm doing basically exactly the same as before. So just rendering and shaping that hair. I do apologize, I am covering the camera, but I thought I'd still keep this in because it gives you a bit more of a look and saves you rewinding the other section. So this is pretty much just replicating what I've done. Obviously, the portraits aren't going to be 100% accurate. You are doing it by hand, so don't stress too much. The client can never see both sides at once, as long as they look, you know, both effective and obviously both look like the Joker at the end, then the client will be happy. So you can see here I'm just rendering the eye, so up close for the pupil, and then generally I usually do that same sort of method where then I run that top shadow and then right around the bottom, and then I shape from there. So I put in my darkest spots first, and then that way I know how dark to go off all your shadows and the intricacies around the eye, which are probably quite difficult to see when you're looking at this video, but if you actually looked at the panels in, then you'd see all those little bits and pieces in there. So you can see I'm shaping out from that area, building that tone and that eye makeup. And as I'm working that in, I'm flicking up with sort of tight dagger strokes just to get those sort of points in the makeup there. And now I'm freehanding in that shadow. I can only barely see that chalk pencil mark, so yeah, I'm just gonna sort of nail it where I think it should go. And yeah, just shaping the forehead. So by shading the sides, it'll obviously pop out the front of the forehead. Don't just flat tone it, because then you're gonna lose all your 3D look. So you can see here now I'm gonna work in that the nose, and then I join up from where I've done around the eye and then shade back onto that nose, remembering that obviously everything's masked up. So if it wasn't and you had to be careful, well, you couldn't go as crazy with the shadowing from a distance. You'd have to be a lot closer. But luckily in the first, like we showed you in the first video, everything was masked up, and that's gonna give us a really crisp three-dimensional look, because this particular portrait is actually behind that card and the glove, so it can be slightly a little more blurry, like it doesn't have to be as sharp. So by masking it up, you're going to get that effect straight away, and it's going to look really effective, especially when cleared. Although that this one got a matte clear, but if this was to be cleared in glossy, or if you decide to give this a go and clear it in glossy, well, that's going to make it look really, really three-dimensional. So you can see here I'm cutting in around that mouth area again, and then blending off all the dark areas. So I'm always sharp where I know that I can go sharp. So whenever you're going sharp, up close, less paint, and just speed up a little bit, and try and be accurate with your tones. And whenever you're colouring in to get a flat tone, remember 50-50 overlap, and paint on, paint off, and always keep the air on all time. So don't get in the habit of just putting the air on and off and air, on and off. The air should be on it at all times. It's a double action airbrush, and that's the best way to use it. And then just pull back on the trigger and control all of your paint flow from your height and how much you pull back on your trigger. Okay, so you can see here I'm just comparing the two and blending either or. So it just gives you a bit of an idea of what they look like. And now I'm just starting to work in a bit of that white. So you can see I'm layering that upon the makeup that we've already done. Okay, so still working with my house of color mix that I have originally from the first video still, so it's fairly thin like I explained before. It's exactly the same white that I used to lay out the flat tone to start with, but you can see now how much brighter that white sits up on top of what we've already done. So now we need to be a little bit more careful because white is renowned for overspray and it can travel quite easily. So wherever you want it bright and wherever you want it sharp, just you've got to go up nice and close. You can come in and fix it later, but obviously if you can keep this step as neat as possible, it just means less time trying to clean up all your overspray later. So up nice and close wherever it meets those black areas. No doubt we probably will have to clean those up because it's extremely difficult to get it 100% perfect without actually, say, using a freehand shield or something like that. So, and because we're doing this whole artwork freehand, apart from obviously masking up the card and the glove, you know, it just takes a little bit more time with this step. So I'm just getting an uneven sort of toning on the makeup. So because I'm layering on top of that, I'm building texture on the skin, and it gives that real sort of crusty makeup look. So you can see with the hair that I just did then, I'm just picking out the strands that are actually the highlighted strands. So don't just go over everything, especially with white highlights. Less is more, and really just pick at your reference and just break it all down. I mean, you can eliminate it, but if you were doing this on something with a flesh tone portrait and you went too crazy with your white, you basically got to just start again. So it's a good thing to just remember with white, accurately look at your reference and just paint what you see and don't overkill it. So, because we don't want to have to rework everything. So all we're doing is picking up the brightest spots. We are leaving what we've already done because you don't want to eliminate that whole step. So just pick out the bright spots, like in the eyes especially, that, you know, the dot in the pupil always makes it look real, and usually some sort of wet spots around underneath the eye that sort of usually helps. You can do that by real fine sort of dots, so going up really close with the airbrush and picking out the strands, especially on this where you've got a black background, so you can just sort of flick some hair strands out and even just some stray ones to make that hair look nice and scruffy. So that's what we do with the white. Now we're on to a black. So this is actually the black that we used on the actual panels. So now what I'm doing here is I'm unmasking some of the sections because that tape will otherwise create a line. So I'm eliminating all of that overspray and I'm just blending back into the original panel. So take your time with this. You can also knock a few things back, you know, some of the strands of hair, just blow over them. Obviously, you could do this with a spray gun as well. I use a mini gun from our water, an LPH-80, which is quite handy. But for this particular project, I didn't really need to use it. These panels are fairly small, so yeah, I just decided to do it with the airbrush. And I think from memory, it's a water revolution that I'm using. Just to blow in those colors because it puts out a bit more paint than my Micron. All the other stuff was done with a custom CMC. Okay, so you can see I'm just working in all of that area, knocking back some of the hair and getting rid of that overspray, and also cleaning up around the base of that where I've masked it up with the application tape and the masking tape. And now I'm going to go back in with that black. So this is actually not the blue black. This is the actual true black of the bike. So because I've used blue black before, I can now go on with this black, which is a solid black, and that will stand out. So if I don't just coat over that whole area, especially in this eye section, I'm going to get that sort of look of a bit of the makeup underneath that black section. And it's going to give you a bit more three-dimensional look. So again, don't just go over everything. This is really just to clean up some of that white overspray that we spoke about, and just to really get the darkest spots only. You can slightly feather over certain areas. Although it's got that brownish tinge, which I explained before, it's not going to be as obvious now that you've got that blue-black toning. So this combo works really well. So I'm just really just hitting the darkest spots. So you can see in the forehead, the crevices there, closest to the darkest part of the shadow. But I'm again not just blowing over that whole shadow. I'm letting that nose look like it's shining through. Now I'm reworking some of the hair just to give it a bit more depth, and also to clean things up a little bit, because it's extremely difficult to get it 100% perfect and just leave it with the white. You can see already now the one on the right is a lot sharper and clearer than the one on the left, and that's due to the fact that I've just run that black over it. So by going sharper with that, it just pops everything back out. And then once we remove the masking, your card and your glove's going to be totally three-dimensional. So it just gives a really good effect. So I'm just working closely on that pupil and then blending out. So you've got to be up close around the eye. And then where your makeup section is, you can come a little bit further away and then paint on, paint off, 50-50 overlap. And if you want, take a look at your reference and you can leave sort of sections out so it's not totally covered and it'll give that uneven look again. So I'm just taking my time now, adding in any last bits of detail as well. So again, working in that shadow area around the nose and then running through on the mouth. It's probably difficult to see off this particular video, but hopefully you can see enough to get the idea. So you saw then I was knocking back that chin area. I want it to look like he's almost emerging. So he's coming out of the darkness, and then you've got the glove and the card in the foreground. So we're sort of creating those layers and the illusion of depth. So I'm just working in the forehead area and then those side sections where the shadows are the darkest, coming off where the hair is, and just sort of working in between the two to try and keep them as accurate as possible. If you're doing multiple portraits, it's definitely always a good way to do it. Do them in the steps. So there you go, that's how they should look. And this was actually, there was an extra step before that photo was shown, which you notice with the black. So on the photo, the overspray was still there, but it still gave you a bit of an idea. So you can see here. Now, all I'm going to do now is come back in with that black, and I'm just cleaning up in on the glove a little bit. So only a few little spots here and there, blending the base section, if there is any overspray that I can see. And as you can see here, I've noticed that some of the cards I find the lines are a bit daggy. So I'm just coming in with some masking tape and I'm just going to clean that up. Now, if you're not confident, you've got to be careful with this. You can obviously tape up that other section, so tape up the whole portrait. Because if you come back too far, you will get overspray on the other side of your masking tape, which will show right through the card. So just keep that in mind. If you're not confident with your freehand skill, just paper off the background or the areas that you don't want overspray on. Okay, so now I've just switched to the white, so the original white that we used. And all I'm going to do now is just, again, like I said to you with the face, what I was doing with the last minute highlights, I'm doing the same with the glove. So I'm going to put the stitching in and just the really bright white highlights on all of the creases in the glove. And just sort of adding the highlights to give it contrast and really make that sort of leather look that we spoke about in the first video. So okay, so you can see I'm just working it all in, being careful not to get any overspray. You see that I did the stitching then, and I'm just building up on those high spots in the gloves. Bit of uneven texturing as well, just to make it look more like material. It's not going to be 100% flat, so you want to shape it and put the time into it. Although they're, you know, it's a little piece, it's the focus of this particular painting, so don't cut any corners. Still just working that in. I'm just going to render the Batman character. So just, again, up close. I'm just going to pick out like the muscle tones, all the highlights on there, just to really give his suit that particular shine. And to make it look more three-dimensional as well. So these are all the little bits and pieces that, you know, a lot of people probably look at it couple of steps before and think, yeah, that looks fine, but if you spend a bit more time and you pay attention to detail, it just makes such a difference with your work. So always recommend you know, to all of my students, just take your time, patience is everything, and paint what you see, and you know, just really try and put every little bit of detail in. So I'm just going back over everything, making sure I've got everything. And here you go. That's what the fairings look like completed. So, hope you like the end result. And this is a picture of the actual, or a little bit of a movie of the bike. So, all together. So, you can see the bike consists of both glossy and matte finishes. And, yeah, you can see here, it's a pretty crazy looking bike. All the customizing and assembly was completed by Bikecraft, and they also did the matte and gloss clear. I hope you enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you again soon.